would love to introduce, and I'm honored to do so, Kalev Peekna, who is a managing director at One North and our chief strategist. Kalev always wears a bow tie, and you only know that something's a little bit off when it's undone or he's not wearing it. So we're looking good this morning because he's in one piece. Kalev is going to be setting the context, talking about breaking the bimodal, and I'm really excited for him to share his content with you. So without further ado, here's Kalev.
Hi, everybody. So my name is Kalev, and that rhymes with... you guys have been here before. It's true, I do wear a bow tie. In fact, there's a running discussion at One North about whether or not I have a neck. I'm not sure, I'm not sure if I do. I'm really excited to be here. I'm really excited to go first, frankly, because then I can get it out of the way and have fun. It's a real honor to be able to take the first presentation, because what you do in this kind of presentation is set up the whole day. Now, often in years past, I give what we kind of call like a state of the state type of talk. I go out and do a bunch of research on your behalf, and I come to you with data and research that we've done, and just try to give you the lay of the land. But this talk is a little different. And instead of talking a lot about the world out there or One North's world, I'm going to be talking to you about what's happening actually within your world, within your marketing departments, within your firms. And instead of a big data review, which you will get from other people, including people like John Simpson and Ryan Schulz, they'll fill that out for you. This talk is more of an exhortation. It's a plea, a request, to ask you guys to look at something that is happening from a different perspective and quite possibly change it. Okay? So, you guys know that One North loves a theme. If you've been to One North, the lab before, everything's got to have a theme that ties it all together. And in the past, here's some of the ones we've done before. We did relationships, and I gave a talk about storytelling and narrative structure and how that draws relationships together, which is why it works so well in marketing. In 2014, we talked about reinvention, and you all got to see me in makeup. And even take a vote on which look was better. I still think the smoky eye is the consensus. And then last year, I got to play you a bunch of music, which was super fun, because we were talking about the theme of orchestration, and I was tying that to marketing. And so I love a theme. I love taking that idea and pulling a thread out of it and then weaving something together out of that, which is why when they told me that this year we would have a sports theme, I was a little dismayed. In fact, I think that was the look on my face because Jen Bullitt came up to me afterwards and was like, dude, are you gonna be all right? So I have to explain that a little bit because this was like what last night was like, right? This is how people watch sports, right? The problem is this is how I watch sports, right? Everybody at One North knows this. This is more for the rest of you. And so it does bear a little bit of explanation. You're probably going to see a lot of quotes from like inspirational sports figures. This is Billie Jean King, who's reminding us that it's not really like the core natural talent that makes you great. It's all the dedication and hard work, which is what, you know, a lot of people will tell you over and over. I have to say, I think my parents would disagree. Now, to explain this, when I was six, my parents enrolled me in a tumbling class because my sister was a pretty accomplished gymnast and they thought, let's get another one out. And after 2 weeks, when they came to pick me up, they handed the money back to my mom and said, he can't stay. Because despite 2 weeks of effort, I had not managed to somersault, which means I have less natural athletic ability than that panda. So the solution, though, because they still wanted me in some kind of program, was they put me in a German class, which is why I still know how to say, I'm sorry, Mom and Dad, in German. So to update that a little bit, I'm actually going to show you, this is the best explanation of my complicated relationship with sports. These are things I have actually said. And you're going to have to rely on the One North team to verify these. But so a lot of times with sports, I'm just kind of perplexed as to what the big deal is. This was actually from XLab 2 years ago. You can go out on YouTube and hear me say this, which is... I don't know why people like to watch millionaires in their pajamas, but they do. Sometimes I'm just confused. It's hard for me to keep them all straight, such as the famous example when I called baseball throw ball and described it as the game with the pillows out on the lawn. So I was reviewing this slide with some One Northerners actually late at night. Cammy, who will be here a little bit later, and she is the one who pointed out to me, you know, they're not like pillows anymore. They're actually these hard rubber things that are embedded into the ground, which is the moment when I realized that pretty much everything I know about baseball was informed by Madonna in A League of Their Own. God bless Madonna. Where would we be without her? I mean, 35 years later, and she's still showing us the way. This is an actual text. Like, I just had to take a picture off my phone for this. This is what happens when I find myself stuck in discussions about sports. So again, we were reviewing this slide where I was getting really mad at Sarah and Dawn for having abandoned me to this conversation, and then John Simpson checked the date and realized I was talking to him. Yeah, it wasn't good for my career, but okay. Sometimes I get like a little perplexed, like when people ask me to join in, I don't understand why they're making that request. And sometimes I get aggravated. So during March Madness, when everybody around the office was streaming the games on their computers while trying to do it, and they were like interrupting the meeting to say, God, this guy bounced a ball really good, yay! And I still might make good on this promise. I still might make good on this and find a way to loop the Paris fashion shows. But most of the time, I just like to mess with people because I do know a little bit more than what is such as when I pretended that I didn't know what the heck the Super Bowl was. So I have an outsider's perspective. But I realized as I started this, like that can actually be a good perspective, right? You come at it almost like an anthropologist. You have a little bit of a distance and therefore a little bit of objectivity. So I did what any non-sports loving geek does when they face a situation like this. I went to the data, of which there is tons, and it's pretty impressive, right? It's a huge industry. I mean, just to call it a few things, it's a $1.5 trillion industry globally. A full third of that is the US, and we are not a third of the world's population. Like, we're obsessed with sports. What's also interesting is that the vast majority of that does not go to the players, so the average professional athlete in the US makes only $45,000 a year, right? What's also interesting is what counts as a favorite sport. So the Harris poll does this every year. If you go online, I was even kind of fascinated to see how this has shifted over time. They've been doing it for at least 30 years. And they just ask a very simple question, what's your favorite sport? And they keep track of that over time. So these are what people answered as their favorite sport in 2016. And I think if you take a closer look at this list, you'll see some interesting trends. The first is, it is true, women's sports has a long way to go. Most people would like to watch students of the male variety than watch professional women's sports, even if it's the exact same sport. So that's a bit sobering. We have really quirky ideas about athleticism. golf is not a favorite sport outside the US, at least in most places outside the US. It might be because they don't count it as a sport, but... And the other thing is that our sports, we like them really fast in the US. So what's actually interesting about that is that of those four, and really only three if you count men and women's soccer as one sport, are considered endurance sport. And trust me, that was not my opinion. That's checked by ESPN. They all require a lot of effort and training, but in most of those, there are very specific skills and short bursts of activity. with, frankly, a lot of pausing in between. In fact, I wanted to ask you guys, what you're not seeing on this list are activities like this. So, like, how many people have taken a bike ride, gone hiking, gone skiing within the last year or so, right? So you all do those things. How many people have played, like, a full-on game of adult tackle football in the last year? Nate, I'm totally... I don't think that's what tackling counts as. So, it doesn't seem too hard to me. I know, it's cruel, but I had to laugh, and then I had to put it in the deck. It makes me feel like a bad person, but I'm still smiling, so it's okay. So the first reason about why don't the endurance sports show up on that list, when we get asked about our favorite sport, we tend to talk about, like, what's the most entertaining sport to us, not the one we actually like to do, which I think is just interesting. Also, just having a long attention span is not fashionable right now. I don't know if it'll ever be fashionable again. It's right up there with churning butter and darning socks as a modern life skill, right? Commercial breaks. So Sarah Levine Meyer, you know, I once went to the sport with the orange bouncy ball, basketball, in New York. It was literally the only basketball game I've ever gone to. And I was astounded that when you're in the stadium, at some point, the entire sport just stops for a TV break. I just had no idea. I was literally looking around being like, what? They're just going to stop? And we're all in the stadium just going to sit here and twiddle our thumbs for a few minutes while they play commercials? And the answer is yes, because that's what pays for it. And I think this has a huge influence. If you can imagine what it's like to try to televise an endurance sport like a marathon and still make money off of the commercials, right? Like, it's really hard. It's not a periodic activity that gives you natural breaks, right? And then finally, and this is probably the most important, we really all like a quick win. We like a quick, big win. So I want you guys to think about this as I oh so casually pivot to the marketing point. I actually realized when I looked at my previous deck that I have a slide that says almost exactly this in all of them, so apparently I like to go off on a tangent at the beginning and then find the relevant point. So I want to talk to you about something that's called the bimodal problem. Oh, also, I did in my research find a bunch of random stats that had nothing to do with anything, so you can look for them there. Such as this one, where there are only two games in the entire year where we don't have a professional sports game. Okay. So going into the bimodal problem, this is what it looks like. And I'm going to just explain it a little bit and hope that you guys understand what I'm talking about. So we have one dimension called time, right? This just describes time. The other dimension is effort, and the area underneath the curve is the money you are spending on the effort. That's actually your investment. And it describes basically the way that marketing departments that we work with and professional services organizations approach their digital investments. And that digital investment can be a website, it can be CRM, it can be email marketing, whatever, but this tends to be how they approach it. This is how they think about it. So to narrate that through, I'll just give you a website example. So in that first year, that's when you do like a redesign, you build the website, right? And it's a pretty large investment. And it takes a lot of effort, and you go through that redesign. And then over time, you run that platform, but with relatively minimal investment, especially compared to the money you spent putting it up in the first place, until basically it gets old and a little bit stale, and time comes, and you have to redesign again, right? It's called bimodal. It's a term that comes from economics and other data analysts because it basically indicates two different modes or contexts of activity. Right? So anything that has this kind of like camel hump thing says, well, you have two different ways of acting. And in this instance, you have a way of acting where you're investing heavily and improving the thing or maybe replacing the thing. And then you have a mode, right, that where you're basically not doing anything, right, or very little. You kind of think like the best model from outside your life is like you approach it like buying a car. Right? So you spend a lot of money on it up and run, and then in between, you just have the car, and you drive the car, and you might fix it, and you might get new tires or get the oil change, but you're not throwing that much money into it, or at least you're hoping not to. And then later, when you get sick of it, and it's old, or you need another car, right, like you buy a new one, and you completely replace it. So I hear some nodding. Does this seem like it makes sense, or I see some nodding? Yeah? you recognize that this is true? Okay, good. Then the entire premise for my talk is not false. So I actually realized as I was talking through this with one client, I slipped up and called it the bipolar problem. And then only afterwards did I realize this is actually like a pretty good description of especially what it's like to live through this from your point of view. So yes, this one's actually really relevant. I wasn't gonna stop, but I just wanna point out in baseball, even though this seems like a really long game, the average baseball game only has 18 minutes of actual action in it, right? Again, from ESPN, don't blame me. So this is why it's the bipolar problem. So when you start off, everything is awesome, right? Yeah, totally. You got your money, they approved it, you're ready to go. It's just fantastic. And you start getting into it and you have a kickoff and a super cool agency like One North shows up and it's all about the possibilities and you're like, yay, I hope we can get it in purple. It would be so awesome. And it starts to feel like you start to put in a lot of work and you're like, oh wow, like a little bit more work, but you're gunning for it. You're like, yes, I will rewrite every single bio. I will do it. You know, it's fantastic. And then you like have this moment, you're like, whoa, what did I sign up for? But you recover quickly because like the end is in sight and you know maybe the design is cool or if it's a CRM, like what you're gonna be able to do is so awesome and the data you're gonna be able to get is gonna make your life incredibly fantastic. And then you launch and of course like as every marketer does, like you celebrate that by buying some swag that will then end up in a donation box, but it doesn't matter right now because it's gonna be incredibly awesome. And then, you know, you have a little bit of regret because you're starting to watch the budget numbers, but you recover again. You're like, okay, I'm just going to fix a few things. We're going to still going. I won't do this time. But then certain things start to happen. Like, you've been spending so much effort on that one thing that you have completely neglected your day job, right? And you've got a million other things to do. So then you have to start working on that. Like, you just can't, you don't have a choice anymore. Especially after a year of just trying to get through this one big thing. And then, you know, like maybe a competitor launches something and you're like, oh, it's just like that much cooler, but we're still cool, I'm okay. And you start to regret, like, I guess we didn't really get around to rewriting every single bio and yeah, they're still kind of the same. And then, you know, you're about 2 weeks out and you're kind of like, yeah, it looks okay, but now maintaining it is a pain. Like, you don't like the idea that you have to fix it. And pretty soon you're just sick of it, right? Like it's only been 2 years, but because you haven't changed everything, you've been looking at like essentially the same homepage for 3 years, right? Like you're getting sick of it. And then eventually you become embarrassed to show it. This is actually, we all agreed, something that we hear a lot. Like if people come talk to us, like they are actually embarrassed to let anybody see it. And it's just like why you can't have nice things at home, right? And then the irony sets in, right? So like, then this blame storing comes in. You're like, who decided on this? And it's been enough time that you don't remember that it was probably you, but that doesn't matter because that was like 2012 you. Like you cannot be held responsible for 2012 you. That's totally unfair, right? And then, like, you're just seething in rage, right? Like, you just come in every day, and it just ticks you off. Like, what it is ticks you off. But you start to notice that rage is shared by other people. As you begin to, like, admit it, you start realizing, oh, my gosh, like, a lot of people don't like this thing. And you start to get a plan, right? As soon as the partners start to hate it, you start to see a crack in the foundation. And then you use that to make a business case, right? You're like, yes. This thing is the worst thing that has ever happened to this firm, and if you don't change it, you might as well shut down the shop and move on. And so then your business case gets approved, and guess what? The whole thing just starts all over again, right? That's the entire bipolar cycle, right? It's actually a little worse than you think, right? Like, that was pretty bad. So apart from the emotional whiplash, there's other things that happen, right? So, you know, we used a website example, but chances are you're probably approaching a lot of things like this. Each year, you've probably got, like, a big project At least that's what we've discovered that's going on. And that might be web. You might be like, next year it's CRM. Then we're going to reinvest in the brand. Then I'm going to do email marketing. Then I've really got to get a handle on the proposals. Then are we really going to start this new event program and start up the CLE thing until eventually it comes time to do the web again, right? So you're just on this endless, like, I feel awesome about some things, but everything else sucks, and then I feel awesome about this one thing, and you're just up and down every single year. The other thing, which is the curve is a little bit of a lie, because the truth is, and we all know, is that as you go through those things, the next time is always more expensive than the previous time, right? And here's one of the biggest reasons why. When you approach things as a redesign or replatform, when the task, every single time that you have to go up on that curve, is to replace the thing before, there's this fundamental assumption that you have to repeat or build and keep every single set of existing capabilities, right? So the minimum, right, like you can't go back to the firm and say, like, in any dimension can we do less? You have to keep all of that forward. But of course, you can't just replace, you have to improve on it. Right, so you have to add new capabilities. And then the next time, that actually becomes the floor for the next one, right? And it just keeps going and going and going, right? I like to call that term feature hoarding. And it's not that everybody is super OCD or just like wants to gather it. It's because of the way that you approach everything as a redesign and because of the way you make business cases to a firm that this actually becomes what you have to do. You're constrained by this. So this is costing us, and I think costing you guys, a lot. I think actually it leads to overspending, particularly the feature hoarding part, I think leads to this notion that there's just too much spend going on replacing things that already work. And in fact, with every single redesign, you're probably spending a lot of money replacing some things that do work, right? You are strategic, I think most of our clients, like I think it's true that professional services marketing, whether it's management consulting or accounting or legal, I don't think it's true that they're never strategic. I think they are, but if you approach things in this cycle, you're probably only strategic with the one big thing you're doing that year, right? Because everything else, you're just running the platform, right? And you're hoping that strategy lasts for 5 to 7 years. There does tend to really focus you on that platform. Again, because you approach these major investments as redesigns, you have to deal with a lot of the nuts and bolts of replacing entire platform. And that means you're focusing on that tool at the expense of what you actually should be doing with it. It does lead to a little bit inability to react to market conditions, right? Like if you're year 3 or 4 with your website, and something happens and you feel like you should do something new, I bet most of you probably automatically assume, well, like, I can't get a redesign for another couple years, so we'll just have to wait to respond to that. And we saw a lot of that with responsive design. When that came along and when mobile web became very important, the vast majority of people really were constrained and were unable to address it until it became time for them to do a redesign. Right, they just kind of sucked it up and said, well, I guess we just won't work on a phone until it's time. So why does this keep happening? Thanks, Bill Murray. There's a lot of reasons. I actually think a big part of this deep psychological assumption. Projects and matters and engagements are how PSOs actually solve problems, especially the practitioners. This is literally what they do with their clients. Right, you get a big business problem, let's set up a project, by the end of it I will be done, and then I can go away and go on to the next client. And that actually directly informs the way they think about how problems are solved. I have to say a big thing is the way that this draws all your attention to one thing becomes this self-fulfilling cycle, right? Like you have a big project, it does, it can suck the life out of a marketing department, it can start taking over everything else, and not just the budget, your attention. And that means that you have no option but to start moving on to other things once it's done, right? We tend to think in campaigns. This is a little bit of the marketer stuff. We tend to think in things that are launched. Like, we love a good launch, right? And we love a big splash. And we believe in the power of the splash. I'm going to just ask you to say, like, you can still have a splash without doing that much to the actual platform underneath it. Again, I feel like that's confusing the tool and the platform with what you're actually trying to do with it. Of course, everybody likes shiny new things. I like shiny new things. This is another one. a psychological thing that comes from the outside, which is this fear that once the project is over, you will never be allowed to touch it again, right? Meaning you have to throw everything into it at once because you won't be allowed to do anything to it. You won't get a single dime for it later, right? This is interesting. This is part of the bipolar cycle. The way we make business cases is that you probably actually need to achieve terrible in order to convince anybody to let you achieve great, right? Like, you have to make that business case out to be, in fact, how many people would admit that in making a business case, they might have kind of sort of used language that exaggerated a little bit in terms of how awful something is? I've totally done it, yeah. Right? Like, that's the way it seems to work. And we do it because it works, right? Like, throwing up a big screed about how terrible something is creates the sense of urgency and gets you the dollars that you need. And then finally, of course, only a big, huge, quick win, something as a big change, can make it seem worthwhile to the people who are paying for it, right? That makes sense. So let's look at an alternative. Obviously, the first thing you want to think about is, like, how do I just even this out? Right? Like, how can I get this curve to be not so high and not so low and have more continuous improvement? Of course, flat, completely flat, is probably not realistic. In real life, it's probably going to look a little bit like this, right? But that's the goal, right? I want to get this thing so that I don't have to be on this roller coaster anymore. And what, you know, really happens to the overall spend? You know, does that mean I'll never be able to spend this much, or will my marketing budget just have to go down? Like, I don't think any CMO or anybody in charge of their budget likes to see year over year that it's going down, right? That feels constraining. I don't think total it goes down. It's just that you're able to distribute and spread it around amongst more things, right? So if your web budget, this just totally makes up, kind of looks like this year over year, right? Some a little bit, times a little bit higher, others a little bit lower, but without a spike, that leaves you room to start taking care of the other things and to be continuously improving more than even just the one platform, right? Like, you can keep going on brand, you can keep going on CRM, you can keep going on email marketing. And the total might be equal to that giant spike that you had, right? Like, you still might be spending a lot of money year over year, but the benefit is that each program is still moving forward and it's evened out and no one thing is taking over all of your budget and all of your attention. There are some, of course, good benefits to this mindset. It does tend to come from product development and software development, but first of all, there's no presumption of obsolescence ever, right? The presumption actually is that you will keep going. The investment improvements, they're iterative, they're incremental, they're sustained. Every single year it gets a little bit better. There's predictability of spend over time. We'll, you know, remember this when we start talking about how to convince firms to do it. It's a lot more predictable, right? A lot fewer surprises. There's an increased ability to, like, assess market conditions and then actually react to them. And the coordination with other platforms is easier. And finally, of course, no more giant redesign projects. So any real life examples? Yes, of course. We're gonna start with Apple and Amazon. I know, okay, we bring these two up every single year. You guys are super skeptical. Just hold your groaning for a little bit, okay? Stay with me. This is a question we often ask people when we start this. When's the last time that Amazon.com redesigned? So courtesy of the Wayback Machine, which is a tool that you will find a lot of people using today to kind of show things over time, I'm going to actually show you what Amazon looked like. So this is Amazon in 2016. This is what it looked like in 2017. 2008. Little changes. They kind of put a search in. They took it out. They put the search back. That's interesting. Kind of the same, but also a little bit different. They took the search out again. They really just can't decide if they want that search there. put the search back. Okay, that looks like a little bit different, but if you look at, like, the visuals, it went wider, but actually it's still kind of the same stuff. The categories disappeared, but the categories actually just went into here, so it's all there, right? This is when they were launching that whole frustration-free packaging. Nice try, Amazon. I still open packages. It still takes me 10 minutes to unwrap that stuff. Like, but it was such a good idea. I really applaud them for that. Here, okay, they went with the big hero image, but again, the navigation, the options, kind of the same. 2015, they kind of went dark. Again, most of the stuff's still the same. And then this is what it looked like last week, right? I'm going to ask to do the same thing with Apple now, right? So this was Apple in 2006. Remember this? 2007. A little bit of a big change. Went dark 2008. Oh, they moved the navigation up to the top, put a little search into it. Here, oh wait, not too much of a change. Oh, they moved the navigation back down. They can't decide where they want that bar to be. Here, oh, they went all glossy and glass. That kind of makes sense. Their iPhone went all glassy at the same time, right? Now they put in like stronger divisions in the navigation. They changed up kind of the structure away. It's still glassy. Ooh, went flat. Now it's dark, right? Went a little bit more premium. It's taking up the full screen. They kept that for a bit. And then it, recently with the iPhone 7, they went full on just like black and white, right? So when did they redesign? Well, it's a philosophical question, right? The answer is either they never did or they always did, right? But if I take pictures from the beginning and the end, you're going to see the change over the broad period of time is just as strong as any redesign. Like if you went into Amazon on Friday and it looked like it did in 2006, and then you came in and it looked like it did on Monday and it looked like it did in 2016, you'd say, oh, Amazon.com redesigned. But at no single day along the way did you probably have that experience, right? Did you log in? No single day did you come in and some morning you thought, oh, Amazon changed their homepage, right? You probably didn't notice any of those changes, right? And the same thing for Apple, right? 2006, it looked like that. 2016, it looked like this. It's a huge change, but only over 10 years, right? So they're doing it, I get it. You're not Apple and Amazon, you're not that cool, you don't have their money, you don't sell products. But actually, we do observe a lot of PSOs starting to handle things in this way. So it is true, right? And in fact, I think PSOs beat themselves up a little bit about this. No, you may not be cool. Cool may not be an aesthetic that is close to your brand, right? But I think most PSOs are actually really good at being strategic. I'm just going to quickly go through Deloitte, McKinsey, and BCG to show you how that looks. So Deloitte is kind of interesting because for a long time they really seemed stuck in that bimodal cycle. This is what their website looked even 4 years ago. They added some cookie stuff, but like really, it's just the same. It's the same. It's the same. And then in 2015, whew, big redesign. I don't know if you guys noticed this, but like this was one of those instances where I came in Monday morning and it was just completely different. Right? So they went for this like card-based design, tile-based design. They completely changed it. It's responsive. The branding looks different. They were changing everything at once. Classic redesign. And the homepage just went on forever. And in fact, there's three more scrolls past that I won't bother you with. But like, there was just a ton of stuff. What I thought was interesting is that even just a few months later, it was clear to me that they had already made changes. So the visual part's the same. But now the homepage is more weighted, and they've really limited the amount of content that's coming. So it's obvious that somebody was like, we're not sticking with the same homepage. Maybe it's because it didn't work. Like maybe throwing all that content didn't work, so they changed it. And then earlier this year, they actually did a visual redesign. Right? Same brand, but they, maybe that design wasn't actually testing out well for them either, all those rounded boxes. What's fascinating is that the content strategy, the strategy behind the homepage is the same, but just the visuals change completely. And I won't go into it, but if you dive into the interior, you would see again, year over year, even month over month, it's clear that Deloitte has no interest in going back to that site that was just basically completely the same for years on end. Right, they're still tweaking and improving. This is what happened with their career site too. They used to have a separate career site. They folded it into the main site. They had this whole content campaign based on like life at Deloitte. And then when the 26 redesign, not only did it visually redesign with the rest of the site, but they shifted the content strategy. So even though they had completely replaced the career site the previous year, they still went in and restructured the content and shifted from life at Deloitte to talking much more about the recruit, this whole explore your fit, right, and focusing in on them. McKinsey, somewhat of a similar story, but actually a little bit interesting. How many people remember this site, right? Like, this is a gold standard site that a lot of people really liked. It wasn't responsive, however. As it starts to change here, what's interesting is that was a very subtle change, and I'm just gonna say, does anybody wanna spot the real change, apart from the content? Does anybody spot the change? Go back. Go forward. Nope, I'm gonna point it out. It's actually pretty big. It's not visual design. They added a login and a ton of personalization into it, which was really fascinating. Hold on to that thought. In 2014, again, it had nothing to do with the homepage, but they actually took the entire separate McKinsey quarterly site. All their thought leadership used to be on a separate site, and they started bringing it in. They brought it into the main website. So it's a huge change, right? They brought in all this content, integrated it into its taxonomy, created this home for it inside the main website. They continued to do it. I actually don't have it here, but they actually started folding in different location sites. So they had separate sites for Germany and London and China, and they were starting to fold it into the main site. And at the end, they redesigned. Now, what's interesting about their strategy is, first, quickly with careers, same thing. So they brought the careers into the main website, and they created a new content structure. And very similarly to Deloitte, the very next year, they redid all their content. Right? They didn't leave it alone and think like, oh, our career site is, that's it. We'll be like that for 4 years. We'll change all the content. And then of course in 2016, they went ahead with the same redesign because it was part of the main website, right? So main website redesigns, careers now automatically gets the same lift, right? What's interesting is you do see that big redesign at the end, but that's just the visual part. What's fascinating is that I have to imagine that McKinsey knew that they were headed towards that kind of redesign or thinking that they were going to have to do it because it wasn't responsive. It had been the same. The visuals had been the same for a long time. That didn't stop them from continuing to invest into the platform and from dealing with major issues like starting the login and the personalization, bringing the quarterly content in, integrating careers into that site. Like every single year, they're still making improvements, even though there's a visual redesign at the end. And in fact, that's the part that is a little bit distracting. It is a progressive strategy of improvement. It's just that the visual part happens to have happened this year. So finally, the Boston Consulting Group. I'm throwing this one just so that I can tell it from the other direction. It's a very similar story, but I'll give you the strategy first and then show you what it looks like. They have for several years, and I've had the privilege of talking to them about this, since 2012, been launching this new program of digital renovation. And for them, it really has to do with dealing with this cross-channel digital presence. But here's how they decided to go about it, because it doesn't sound like the way that many of us would have gone about it. It was actually kind of different. They actually decided to start with a new career site, a separate career site for now, but a lot of that was to work out kind of a new brand platform, new messaging, new visuals, and to use it as kind of a test case for how that branding would work. After that, they went with a new main.com site, and then they incorporated some of the branding from careers. Then they actually reintegrated careers into main.com. That sounds shocking, but that was always part of the plan. Right? We'll rebrand the separate career site, see how it works, then we'll redo the main site, and at that point later, we'll bring in the careers. Then they handle the globalization of the main.com, very similar to McKinsey. They started closing all the separate location sites and folding it in. And what they're working on right now is trying to, similarly again to McKinsey, bring the BCG perspective sites, which is where all their thought leadership is. Now they're trying to fold that into the main.com. Here's what it looked like. What year was this a good idea? I'm ashamed to tell you how actually recent it is. This is not a design from 2005, though it looks like it. They were stuck that this is what the careers section looked like, right? So it actually was part of the main website for a while. In 2013, it just looked the same. Finally, they pulled careers out and did this complete new branding. Much nicer looking, right? And a completely different way of structuring their content and telling stories. In 2015, that's when they launched the main website, and you can see somewhat of the relationship. They completely changed. I mean, that's not that big green collection of content anymore, right? Completely different redesign. In 2016, what's fascinating is that that homepage got changed again. This is them living up to the idea of we're never getting stuck in that exact same design, exact same homepage ever again, right? It's not that there was anything wrong with this, they just decided it's kind of time to do another thing altogether. And then they really did reintegrate the careers website into the main website. And it worked because they were attentive to how the branding would align, because they braced the branding on the main website on what they had done with the careers website. They actually were able to reintegrate it. And then finally, here's how they started bringing in the globalization functionality, where now the site, in place of several different mini sites, now the site will detect your location and start to adjust the content and language to suit you. All right. Going for endurance. Thank you. Yes, this is all for you. It did occur to me. Sarah went to Bates. Sorry, that's what that little interchange was about. So what does it take? You remember at the beginning I said, like, this was a talk really about you, because what it's really going to take to get off this are changes that have to start with you. So the first is actually moving from a project mindset. We had talked about that. We had talked about how PSOs solve problems in projects and starting to think about it in terms of programs. And the big difference isn't necessarily the work that you have, it's how you approach it and how you structure it. So project has a defined beginning, middle, and an end, right? There are no projects without end dates, right? In fact, managing to that end date and making sure you hit that end date is kind of like the essence of project management. Right? Like, it's hard to have a project that doesn't have deadlines like that. It tends to approach everything as one big effort. It has its own schedule, meaning projects run on their own schedule. They tend not to be tied to the schedule of other projects or even the business overall. And they tend to be very execution focused. The flip to that, to a program, is that the assumption, even from the very beginning, is it literally never ends, right? It's an arrangement of successive efforts instead of one big effort where you solve everything at once. Right? It can be, in fact, it should be tied to your financial or governance structures. Like, a good program is tied to your quarterly structure inside your firm, or it's tied to your annual fiscal year. That's how they work well when there is that alignment. They tend to be executive level led, and they're vision focused. So, first thing is, yes, you still need a vision, even though you're talking about doing things in an incremental way. You do need a long-term vision. But the first key is to take that big, giant project and everything that you wanted to do in that big, giant project, where you do a ton of effort, and then you release it, and then maybe you tweak it from there, and just start breaking it up into chunks that make sense. Right? So just trying to set it up into a sequence of releases. Of course, with the diagram, this kind of implies that they're all the same duration and size. That doesn't have to be the case, right? But the notion is, let's start chugging it up. And this one thing, which I actually think can be really hard to do, right, to start thinking about something like a CRM or an email marketing system or a website and chunk it up into releases, this thing, more than anything else, I'm going to tell you, is actually the key to getting the control and the flexibility and the predictability that we all say we want. You also have to rethink a lot about how you approach scope. So this comes from our experience, particularly with working on something like a website, is that when we ask people, what are you trying to do in the website, or what are we solving for, it's a very first basic question, right? We get almost everything in here, right? They say, okay, we have some brand issues, we've got to have a new visual design, because I just told the other ones that it was so bad looking that it was hurting them, so it's got to look completely new. I want to replace the tech platform. We want to fix some data integrations, or the services need to be restructured, so on and so forth, right? And that's what leads to these giant redesign projects, because, of course, life is so much easier when you try to solve every single problem at once, right? So you need to rethink a lot about it. In fact, first thing is actually, like, maybe that first step where, yes, maybe you have to replatform and get on a much better tech platform. Fine. Maybe you do need a completely new look and feel just because of the way the branding has aged, or the way that one platform has stayed the same even though your brand has evolved, right? Like, maybe you have to do that. But you do need to ask yourself, do I have to solve everything all at once? Or can I, even after that initial release, take certain things and structure them out over time, right? Like, can I chunk it up? And do I need to fix all the data integrations, or can I add some of those a month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months later? Can I deal with that content rewrite? Like, will the world end if everybody's bio goes up as it is now, or can I actually afford to rewrite them later? Can I make a focus that a focus after launch? That sort of thing. Of course, if you're not facing an immediate need for a redesign, if you're like kind of actually in the trough of the cycle, right, you're not right up against the next big spike, you actually have a lot more flexibility. I think it's actually much easier to get going on this than if you're facing an impending need for a redesign, right? So you can actually start setting the releases to deal things with a brand reposition, you can deal with localization, you can deal with services restructuring, and you can deal with them in almost any order, really. The order of those things doesn't have to be dictated by the platform and what state it's in, it can actually be dictated by the priorities of your organization. It is true some things won't fit into a release. I'm not saying like everything becomes a 3-month effort. A classic example for us is something like personalization, which a lot of our clients really want to get started working on or are starting to work on. It's true, you may have to approach it kind of like this. You may have a release where I'm going to focus just on the integration and the planning for it, right? Second release, maybe I'll actually design and build it out. Third one, maybe I won't do much to it except run it and see how it works and gather some data. And then maybe in the fourth release cycle, for my digital platform, then I'll do another iteration where I'll build out a little bit more, right? Or fix some of the things that didn't work out the first time. The benefit, of course, to doing it this way is that you still have room to do a bunch of other things, right? Like if you chunk it up and span things over releases, then it's not one thing is taking over everything, right? So you don't have to, certain things don't have to age while you're getting other things up to date. You do need to have really good leadership of a program. As we said, they tend to be executive-led. Now, the truth is most of the people who are in charge of digital platforms actually come from a communications background. They're actually communications directors. They're like digital communications directors. That's who tends to own a website, right? And this is what I feel like they feel like internally every time they face a redesign effort. And it's not their fault, it's because it takes over their whole life. They have a full-time job trying to manage and get out actual communications, but then they face this year in which this like terrible, awful redesign project just completely takes them over, right? I think a good program actually has a very different kind of leadership. I think it actually has its own leadership that's not the comms director, and not a lot of PSOs have this type of person in place. I've met somebody from McKinsey who does have this job. He's not actually a communications person at all. His job is to manage their digital capabilities, right? And it kind of looks like this. He's executive level interaction, so like director level above, right? He's got to be able to at least talk to the C-suite and make those cases. This person tends to be focused on vision, governance, performance, does develop digital capabilities across tools, so it's not the web person or the CRM person. It's digital overall, so that person can actually get them to start working with each other, right? They manage cross-functional teams, so it's not just that they have like marketing people working for them or working with them. It might be in a matrix thing, but they might have IT people, they might have marketing people, or business development people, or whoever. And the key to it is they don't have 100 other things to do. Right? So that does raise the question, what happens to the comms director? Here's the great thing. The comms director doesn't go away. They just start managing comms instead of digital platforms. They can actually, they're the ones who then become responsible for focusing on what it's supposed to do rather than the platform itself. You do actually need some business leadership. So apart from that program management, you need to rethink the way you approach the leadership and these things are managed internally. So in my experience, and we do often work on multiple projects within a client, not only do we have a committee, but we have a different committee for every single project, right? I think it's better if that program has its own set of stakeholders and leaders. It's a focused and consistent set of people over time, right? They're the ones governing the entire program and the investments in all the different tools so they can make reasonable calls on priority between one versus the other and can make judgments about investment levels between one and the other, and it's not literally one committee fighting with another committee over the money. They should be able to regularly review the performance, and they should, on that regular release strike cycle, help marketing and the program leadership to set things like scope, budget, what's in every single release. And it might include a lot of different kinds of people, right? That digital director, the comms director doesn't just go away and become powerless because they're the ones focusing on who it, what is actually supposed to do. They have a seat at the table, or at least I would argue they really ought to. It might include CMO, CIMO, other executive leadership, that sort of thing. You do need a lot of data. You're going to hear a ton about data today, so I'm not going to go very deep into it, but data is not a fad. I think a lot of people have been talking about how data-driven marketing is becoming, but I don't think that's ever going to stop. I think in a program like this, not only does it require you to look at data, but it also enables you to look at data and have the data mean something. You should be looking at the data every single step of the way, before release, during release, after release. And here's the benefit. I actually think that if you are stuck in a bimodal cycle, in fact, I think the bimodal cycle is one of the reasons why we're not so great at looking at the data. Because if you are in that trough, it's kind of pointless. Like, you can look at a bunch of numbers about what's wrong, but you know you're not going to get a lot of money or be allowed to do a lot with it, right? So you can't respond to the data. Like, what's the point of, like, looking at a bunch of data and be like, yep, that still stinks, and then move on the next month? Right? The bimodal cycle is what creates a sense of futility about looking at a lot of the data. Right? If you can get out of it, if you can review the data, but actually have the data inform actions on a regular basis and say, okay, the data is showing like, yeah, the homepage is not working that great. I think we need to change it next time. Right? Then looking at the data will become a habit that is seen like to be fruitful and meaningful for you. You do need to get really judgy with your data. This is the other thing, is that if you accept that you want to do things in this more incremental release-based way, you do need to be ready to acknowledge a little bit of failure. Like, you need to put up there that maybe what I did in the last release didn't actually have the effect that I wanted. You need to be able to revisit it and adjust the scope based on that, right? You need to be ready to acknowledge that the vision that I had last year either isn't working or we've decided that there needs to go in a different direction. And you need to be able to adopt a more test and learn effect. So this is just an illustration. If a lot of people come to us and start talking about something like personalization, I'm going to deliberately reuse that example, and they just start imagining amazing things that you can do with personalization, and it's all possible, but we often point this out. If you do all of that at once, like personalize the homepage, then integrate a personalized email thing, then also have like maybe a custom industry-based feed, and do all the stuff to your website, you may implement all that and then realize, man, it's only one or two things that actually move the needle, right? If you approach it differently, like let's say you start with just the homepage, then you gather some data on it, or then you move on to email, you see good results, then you move on to a login, you see mixed results. This is what's going to enable you and your entire team to focus on what actually works. Because again, with the bimodal stuff, if you do everything at once, they may have all been great, data-informed, fantastic ideas, but the reality is there's no effort like that in which 100% of the things perform as they were expected to perform. Right? You're going to have a lot of waste. So data scientists, I will fully admit the data scientist thing is a total fad. So Harvard in 2012 called the data scientist the sexiest job of the 21st century. Nice try, Harvard. it's not like Harvard launching a thing. Harvard people, coolest people worldwide ever. I don't think you need a data scientist, or not what data scientists actually do. But I do think you need probably a good data analyst if you don't have these skills in your thing. I don't think this, unlike the other thing, I don't know that it's an executive level leadership job. I think it's an analyst job. But I do think you need somebody who understands data enough to help you understand, how do I measure success? Like, if I wanted brand awareness, what's the right metric for brand awareness? Right? What am I going to actually measure? And then able to help you measure that from different sources, aggregate them together, and produce those viewpoints that'll let you make decisions. You do need to budget. I have to admit, this is probably the hardest part. This is probably the part that scares you the most. You need to learn how to budget dynamically and iteratively. But here's some of the benefits, right? Here are some things that you can use to make the case. Those big asks, those big giant asks where you're coming in and asking for maybe even up to like $1 million or more on some giant CRM project, they become smaller and less frequent over time. right? No big, giant surprises. And that gets to the second part, more spend predictability. You're probably going to know roughly over time, or be able to predict roughly over time, how much you'll be spending on web, how much you'll be spending on email, that sort of thing, if you go to this over time. You can also avoid the sunk costs and sunk cost fallacies. That's the tied to what we just said about, you know, being modest with your scope and testing and learning, right? Because you're going to have a lot less of, I spent the money on 10 amazing things, but only two of them worked out. And you'll be able to offer them you know, the ability to reprioritize and to pivot on priorities. This is probably the hardest part for you, because internally, I think most of our clients really only budget from one direction. They tend to ask themselves, they define what it is that they want, and then they go ask and say, how much will this cost? This is what I want, how much does this cost? Right? And in technical terms, that's budgeting to scope. I know the scope of what I want to do, now I want to know the budget. What I'm going to ask you to do, or what this requires, is you'll be finding yourself saying, instead of that, you'll be saying, I have this much money, how much can I get done? This is the budget for the next release, what can I get done for it, and how do I divvy it up amongst the different programs? So I have two parting thoughts that actually turned out to be paradoxes before we go on. It is true, yes, if you are a cow in the US, you have a 1 in 17 million chance of being made into a Super Bowl football. That's like the stat I'm going to remember, just so we know. The first is that endurance requires change. This is a theme you will hear from a lot of other people. So some things endure because they never change, like the Statue of Liberty. It's awesome. Doesn't matter what year it is. She's celebrating her 130th birthday this year. Literally the same every single time. It's incredible, right? Other things, like Times Square, are awesome because they change all the time. If Times Square wasn't completely different every time you visited, you'd get really bored with it, right? Like, part of what makes Times Square awesome is that you can go there and see something new, right? And unfortunately, I think marketing in general, and definitely digital in general, leans a lot more to the Times Square. And I'm gonna ask you to consider two different platforms that have both been in the news a lot to illustrate this. So Twitter, as you guys know, how many people have heard about this, like, Twitter can't sell itself thing? So Twitter's been looking for a buyer, and Google was interested, Apple pretended not to be interested, but probably was, Microsoft was interested, and Salesforce was definitely interested, but the Salesforce thing fell through, because even though the CEO really wanted to do it, the CEO's board had an outright rebellion and said, there's no way we're letting you buy Twitter. What I think is amazing about this is that the Twitter has never been more culturally relevant than it is right now. Not only do we go on to Twitter and have a lot of conversations about it, but the rest of the media is constantly reporting about what's happening on Twitter, right? It's never been more influential. It has a ton of users. The problem, if you guys want to know, and if you read these articles, you hear that one of the biggest complaints is simply that Twitter is the same that it was up to 5 years ago. It's really fundamentally the same platform. And as an investor, the fact that it's culturally relevant now isn't as important as confidence that it will become better, more widely used, and generate more money in the future. And because Twitter hasn't found a way to improve itself, they don't have confidence that that organization can actually make it stick. In other words, they're worried that it won't endure because it hasn't changed. Consider, as a flip side, Snapchat. How many people will admit that they actually use Snapchat occasionally? Oh, this is more than previous years. So what's amazing about Snapchat is that it has fewer users, it has the exact same revenue model as Twitter, and its own projections, which are pretty rosy, says it will make less money, but it's about to have an IPO and become one of the biggest tech IPOs in history at upwards of $4 billion. And the reason why is because Snapchat has been relentless about releasing new features, right? It's got little brands up there. It started out as a sexting app. I mean, we need to just recognize that, right? But now brands are out on there, politicians are up there, we're throwing crown heads. I mean, $4 billion just so that you can put your cat in makeup. Even though I think I wore it a lot better than Mr. Fluffy up there. The second paradox is that slowing down can actually win the race. And you guys have heard this cliche, right? It's the tortoise, and the tortoise and the hare, right? Slow and steady wins the race. I'm very data-driven, as you guys know. I believe in actual evidence, which of course comes from YouTube, right? So I want to actually just show you guys this. If you haven't seen it, just enjoy, because it's pretty funny. And it's not showing. Oh, tech fail, guys. All right. Interesting thing about that video is that it is a race against a rabbit and a tortoise, and the tortoise does indeed win. So thanks, guys.
Thank you, Kalev.
You're welcome.
Awesome. So hopefully you can start to see the overall theme shaping up. And I think what's really interesting, as I sat there and think about a lot of the conversations I've had with a lot of you in the room, other clients of ours, is that in order to start enduring, a big change needs to happen. And I think maybe if I'm sitting in your shoes, hearing some of that was probably a little eye-opening. Because the way that a lot of our organizations operate today, because they've just been this way for a long time, are very different. And so I hope that you were able to take some nuggets from this to bring back to start enlisting in that change. And I think what was really interesting to me is, especially in professional services, one of the biggest changes that we do digitally is around the website redesign. You know, I would say that 90% of what we see is the client saying, the marketer saying, oh, we need a redesign. And I think it's really interesting to start thinking about the bimodal versus changing to really the game of endurance. Kalev ran away, but we do have time for questions for him because I think this is a really, really big topic.
Assume if I'm done talking, nobody wants to hear anymore. So
well, that's usually the case, but yeah, right now we're going to give you the floor again.
I'm kidding.
Now what's going to happen is that no one's going to ask a question, and I'm going to run away again.
I have a question, though, maybe, okay. If nobody does. Does anyone have any questions? Don't be shy. That all just sounds great, makes sense.
Anything you disagree with?
Oh, Laura. Okay.
So I understand where you're coming from and the importance of having continual updates on on all sorts of different initiatives. But I'm wondering how you do that in the model of a law firm where everything is about year end and accounting for hours and originations and like the whole model of law firms being about what have you done in this increment of time. And even when you're talking about setting aside money for the next year, how you would do that. And when you're talking about results, I think that a lot of times, just because of the model of law firms, it's really hard to look at it in the long term. That's where I struggle.
I think that that's true, actually. And what I would say is, I think the release structure can be I think the release structure can make it a little bit easier to be more to be focused on the short term with them because they're only making commitments for like the next release or two, right? In fact, actually, I didn't clarify that, but like the long term vision is yours. What you need to work with your stakeholders on, or what you're really only asking them to commit to, is the next release, or and maybe the next release after that, right? So you don't have to ask them for 3 years of money to get it to do it. You only have to ask them for a quarter or two, or however you decide to set the duration of that release. And then what you're gonna say is, I'm only gonna spend this much, and then we're gonna look at how it worked together and decide if we wanna continue investing into it or if whether we wanna invest in a different direction. I think that's the argument. I mean, I think you're saying, like, if I had to go in and convince people to do it, that's part of what I would say is, instead of coming back to you and asking you, surprising you during annual budgeting and saying, I need like $2 million to swap out the entire CRM and email marketing system, or whatever it is, I'm gonna be asking you for money. Like, yes, I predict this year that my budget total will be this, but instead of committing completely, right, and signing a bunch of contracts, We're going to make the commitments on the spend on a quarterly basis. And I think PSOs who tend to watch performance, like especially cash flow on that, would actually find that more comforting. Because then if they come to you and be like, we have to dial back, you're not halfway through something that can't be dialed back. Does that make sense? But I am not going to deny that it's going to be really hard to get the stakeholders off this. Because I think they're assuming this up and down thing as much as anybody else. Any other questions?
We probably have time for one more. All right.
We got one more.
Oh, we have.
So tomorrow morning, I present to our executive committee and policy board our big spend. We're blowing it up.
Woohoo!
One of the things that you said that really hit home for me was, what are we solving for? And I think that's one of the big questions our executive leaders have. And I'm a new leader at my firm, which means the stakes are even higher.
Right.
So when there's everything left to fix, how do you distill the most important, most salient things and talk to them about that?
That is not an easy question to answer to. I think, you know, especially if you're at your moment where you're trying to convince them, align it to what they care about. I think if you, like I said, some people, if you're coming in, especially if you're new to a firm and you've got a platform that has clearly been in the trough for years, yeah, you're gonna have to replace it. Like, there's a certain amount of that you just can't step away from. If you wanted to say, like, how do I lay the foundation for this? Maybe part of it is saying, we have all these things to solve for. This is the first step, and we'll solve for these things. And not either ask to or set the expectation that I will literally solve everything all at once. That leaves you room to go back for another ask and be like, you know, these things I said I wasn't gonna solve for, now it's time to solve for them. Does that make sense?
Yes.
But it's true. I mean, if you're in a trough, you face some kind of replacement at some point.
And I think something else that stuck out to me in the presentation, and I hear about this day in, day out, working with folks like Kalev and other people in our brand and strategy groups, is that research is a huge element too. So a lot of times I think it was really hard to build a business case or come up with a strategy in order to do something like that. And you can start to distill down some of that. Yes, you probably have to recreate, but also thinking about ways you can use quantitative and qualitative data. And we will hear a lot about that today. But to really influence stakeholders, to be a part of the decision-making process and giving them some of the answers, because this is what your clients are asking for. This is what this audience is asking for. And I think that that's really starting to reshape the ways that we can go about some of this, what I'll call business case preparation, or actually trying to figure out what that longer term strategy is that you can break up eventually into releases as you take it down the chain.
Can I go now?
Yes, your excuse. All right, thank you everybody. How about another round of applause for Kalev?